Bismillah, walhamdulillah, and Allah's mercy and blessings and forgiveness be on all of His messengers without making any difference amongst any of them. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Are our actions really presented to Allah on Mondays and Thursdays and also once a year? This is a post I saw once on Facebook. I usually don't go there often, but from time to time I go there and just check what's going around. And that is when I saw this gentleman, and they had this huge, nicely designed poster which says that, again, the actions are raised to Allah on every Mondays and Thursdays, and that's why the fast goes on. It is common belief that human deeds are again raised to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on these 2 days, Mondays and Thursdays, and you're not going to believe the amount of disputes and debates between scholars at which of the 2 days are better, Thursdays or Fridays. And for your information, this is kind of like a trivial information you don't need. They say Monday is better than Thursdays, as if Allah has sent the Prophet Muhammad and all the prophets just to tell us that Monday is better than Thursdays. Anyhow, but so this is what is being said. And the argument that they use are hadiths. This is why today, if you go anywhere in the world, you see a lot of people, they tell you, oh, today is Monday. Are you fasting Monday and Tuesdays? When I used to go to some masjids, the people will just prepare this long stretch and they put food on. Why? Because it's Monday and Thursday. So everybody has this impression and belief that Mondays and Thursdays are special days and thus the fasting. So let us first start with the evidence where all these things got started from. Well, it starts in a hadith reported by At-Tirmidhi. And that hadith has been authenticated and classified as hasan, i.e. good and accepted hadith, by Al-Albani, amongst many. The hadith reads something like follow. I'm just going to read the English. Deeds of people are exhibited or shown or exposed or laid down in front of Allah on Mondays and Thursdays. And then, so I, being the messenger talking, I like that my actions be shown or exhibited while I am fasting. The term in Arabic is tu'rad, and the al-ard is exhibition. It's just like, as I said, shown, exposed, laid down, and just presented. This is where the habit of fasting Mondays and Thursdays come from. In another version, it doesn't stop here, but goes one step further, and it adds another external element, and that is the gates of Al-Jannah, the gates of paradise, will also get involved, and they will be opened. Listen to what they claim the Messenger of Allah said. The gates of Jannah are opened every Monday and Thursday. Then Allah will forgive every human subservient to Allah as long as he does not associate with Allah anything. So you don't commit shirk. Mondays, Thursdays come in. Allah will forgive the sins of everybody. Except in the case of a man who holds a grudge against his brother, another believer. And then it says that hadith says Allah will not forgive them and will tell the angels, wait for these two until they are finished with their quarrel. Wait for these two until they are finished with their quarrel. And the hadith is authentic in Sahih Muslim. And believed or not, the expression of wait until they finish their quarrels is repeated twice. I.e. Allah will tell this to the angels twice. The problem with this, okay, when you keep the Qur'an away from the equation, the problem with this is absolutely incredible. Now, we're going to just remove the Qur'an a little bit, okay? Let's see. After Allah, Allah is high above, okay, and we are down here below on earth. When we do actions and the angels spy on us because they write down what we do, correct? Then they document what we humans have done. And then what they do, they take these actions all the way up to Allah. And it is like I'm hearing the angels right now say to Allah on a Monday, Ya Allah, look at these humans. You left them from Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and part of Monday. And look at what they have done. Then Allah takes a look at each and every document for every human. We are 8 billion people on earth today. Allah will look on Monday and Thursday, of course, at 8 billion documents that the angels present to him. And then the reckoning starts. The judgment starts. And they say that Allah will tell the angels, forgive this, erase that, no, leave that one there. Yeah, that one there, forgive it, and do this and do that. That's what they say happens. Or they claim that the messenger said that happens. Then at some point, two angels will come, but the humans that they are dedicated to aren't in good terms with somebody else, another believer. Now the angel comes in, presents the book to Allah, and Allah will say, oop, no, this one has got a problem with somebody else, and I am not going to forgive them, and I'm not even going to look at their actions until they reconcile and they end their quarrels. That's it. Once they do that, then I will look into their books. Now, please keep in mind, these man-made hadiths were invented in an era where the companions and their followers and the generations that came after that were hating each other. And you know the civil war that broke from the assassination of Uthman, of course, but they started before that. But anyhow, this is from Uthman, until Muawiyah hijacked the kingdom, and that is about 15 to 20 years. In this particular era, everything was supercharged with hate, crimes, killings, and things like that. So these hadiths were widely spread at that moment there. So you can see how the scholars would use them. That if you have a grudge with your brother, your actions will not be looked at by Allah, and you're not going to be forgiven. So what do you think the people who hate each other, who are fighting, it's a civil war, right? Well, people would stop doing that. Well, this is the fact, what I just told you now, it's why these hadiths come from. It's at that particular era. Now, to add more drama to this situation, as I mentioned earlier on, the gates of Jannah will open up. And you might ask yourself, why? Why would the gates of Jannah be opened on every Monday and every Thursday? But Allah says in the Quran that Jannah is not yet created. And it will be created on earth on judgment day. Jannah doesn't exist. No, it doesn't. Yes, the plan of Jannah, how Allah is going to create it, how Allah is going to make it, exists in Allah's knowledge. But is it something that exists right now? It does not. And the Quran says that. Nor does the hellfire. Again, today, it's incredible how we have our beliefs completely messed up. The Quran says Jannah and hellfire or punishment in the grave and all that kind of stuff is nothing, zero, zilt, nada, la shay, nothing at all. But when you hear the people or the sheikhs, the scholars, they talk about some kind of different religion altogether, as if they don't read the Quran, and maybe when they pick up a book of the Quran, within it, it's a book of Shakespeare or some kind of atheist book that they don't know. It's incredible. You will see what I mean by that, okay? The subtle message is that if you don't commit shirk, and don't bring another fight like with somebody else, then that's it. You don't have to worry about your act as long as you do good on Mondays and Thursdays, and also once a year in the midst of Sha'baan, what our brothers in the Urdu-speaking community, or they call it Sha'baan Barat, which nothing else is Sha'baan, Barat Sha'baan. It's let's say that's what it is. It's being away from hellfire. But anyhow, sorry to burst your bubble, but all I have said about Mondays and things like that, it just doesn't exist. Now, here is why the belief that Mondays and Thursdays, humans' actions are raised up to Allah and forgiveness, why all this lie? If you believe in this, you better change that, because you are in deep hot waters, because the Quran says opposite. And you see, as I said before, the Islam and our sheikhs and how they make it is that once they give you a text from Islam, they encourage you not to think. So you take their information, but you don't question it. Because once I tell you what I'm going to tell you, you're going to say, yeah, but why I never thought about that? Well, because you have been distracted. Your thoughts, your thought process that you get is distracted into thinking something else. Now, here is why you should not believe in this lie that our actions are present to Allah on Mondays, Thursdays, and so on and so forth. Simple. Allah is never, ever absent from our lives. Hasn't Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمُ بِمَا يَفْعَلُونَ? Certainly Allah is ever knowing of what they do. Hasn't He said, وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِمَا يَعْمَلُونَ? And Allah knows every detail of any act they do. Hasn't Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ بِمَا يَصْنَعُونَ? And Allah is ever knowing in whatever act they create. Or, as Allah says, قُلْ إِن تُخْفُوا مَا فِي صُدُورِكُمْ أَوْ تُبْدُوهُ. Tell them or say, whether you hide what is in your hearts or reveal it, يَعْلَمُ اللَّهُ. Allah knows it. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. And He knows what is in the heavens and what is in the earth. وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. And Allah is able to know all things, do all kinds of things. It really is amazing, but also at the same time very disturbing, that our sheikhs, scholars, righteous predecessors, and anyone between these guys pretend to believe and follow the book of Allah, and they also tell you and the sunnah, when it should have been we follow the book of Allah full stop. We're not going to go beyond that. But it really is amazing how these people ignore the book of Allah. It really is incredible. And they will go to the hadith and they will believe in the hadith, accept it unquestionably. That's it. The hadith is something you don't touch whatsoever. It never should have been we believe in Allah and the sunnah, the Quran and the sunnah. No, no, no. It should have been, as Allah has said times over times, the belief is in the Quran alone. And always remember, on Judgment Day, the question will always be, weren't the ayat of my Quran read upon you? No hadith, nothing, but nope. They made Allah seem a very confused God. A God that on one hand claims He knows it all. He knows our actions, the big of them and the minute of them. That He is with us whenever we perform our actions. Then He goes around and say that the angel raises our actions twice a week and once a year. And it is then that He sorts out the humans. Forgive this, don't forgive that. If this is as they say, so why do we repent altogether? Why don't we just sin as much as we want between Mondays and Thursdays, and between Thursdays and Mondays? And when Monday comes or Thursday comes, all we have got to do is do an act of charity, do lots of prayers, do lots of istighfar, read Quran, visit your parents, be nice to people. And then guess what? Allah is going to see that you are doing good. Then guess what? He's going to forgive us. Our sins gone, erased. Another disturbing thing is, if Allah takes care of our deeds on Mondays, Thursdays, and once a year, so why do we need Judgment Day altogether? See, because by the time we die, Allah would have already forgiven our sins and would have already decided for us where we're going. It just doesn't make any sense whatsoever. I really fail to understand how Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Al-Tirmidhi, all these scholars of the big shots hadith, Al-Albani, Ibn Baz, Ibn Uthaymin, and even the sheikhs that are alive today. I really fail to understand, and I fail miserably at seeing how can they not understand what Allah says. It's incredible. Look at this, yeah? هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ. He is, i.e. Allah, is the one, i.e. He is the only one who has created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. And the 6 days are periods. It's not the days, the 24 hours, okay? ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى عَلَى الْعَرْشِ. And they always translate this, He establishes Himself on the throne. But it doesn't mean that. What it means is that Allah took full control of them. See, the wrong translation that this expression, istawa ala al-arsh, is that Allah rose up on the throne, and because it's a very complicated term. What they do is they try to make Allah physically ascend a throne, and then they make eight angels carry this throne. Allah says He is the biggest. Allahu Akbar. Don't we say in Salat Allahu Akbar, i.e. Allah is the biggest of them all? If eight angels can carry Allah when He is on His throne, then we have a big problem. Wallahi, we have a huge big problem. But I don't know how the... What it means is this. Al-istiwa is when something has reached its top complexity. That's it. Beyond it, if it goes beyond it, it will not... It will just demolish. It will just go bad. So if someone is cooking a dinner, and we tell him, إِذَا اسْتَوَى الْأَكْلِ, i.e. when the cooking reached the cooking point beyond which it's gonna burn. Switch off the fire. That's it. People would understand this. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, istawa ala al-arsh, i.e. once He finished the creation of the heaven and earth and everything, He took full control over everything and full responsibility over anything and everything He created. What that also means that He did not create the heavens and earth and gave them to somebody else to run them or just manage them. No. So Allah is really precise in the... It's just like a director of a company. See, he makes the laws, he builds the company, and then once he employs people, and that's it. Once the company, the building of the company has finished, the director takes over, and that is istawa ala al-arsh, i.e. he starts managing as if you were a king managing the kingdom. That's all it means. But anyhow, this is not about the arsh. I will talk about it some other day. Okay. But Allah carries on saying, يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَخْرُجُ مِنَا. He knows all that enters the earth and all that comes out from it. And you can take the smallest worm that comes from earth, Allah sees it happening in real life, as it happens now, in the darkest of nights. And He's explained this in the Qur'an a few times. And if something gets in the earth, it's the same thing. Allah sees it. So He knows anything that gets in earth, out of it, in the heaven, in the skies, out of the skies, be that angels, be that birds, be that, and also the seas and the oceans. So He knows everything. وَمَا يَنزِلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَمَا يَعْرُجُ فِيهَا. And all that comes down from the heavens and all that goes up to it. And then He says this, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. And He, i.e. Allah, is with you wherever you are. Right now, as I record this, I am all alone at home. And I have to be extremely sure that Allah is with me right now. How? Doesn't matter. He did not say hi. But how? But is He with me? You can bet everything you got. And guess what? Wallahu bima ta'maluna basir. And Allah of what you do sees it all. So right now He's looking at me, how I'm reading my notes, my research paper, how I'm recording this, how I'm moving my hands, how I talk to you, the microphone. Allah sees things as I do them real life. And there are tons of ayat from the Quran, but I will just add one other ayah, because I don't wish for this talk to be very, 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 very long. But listen to the following ayah. Allah says, أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَةِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Have you not seen that Allah knows whatever is in the heavens and whatever is in the earth? Of course we do. And then Allah says this, مَا يَكُونُ مِن نَجْوَى ثَلَاثَةٍ إِلَّا هُوَ رَابِعُهُمْ. Never is there any whispering among three, but He is their fourth. I.e., whenever there are three people that are in a room, closed room, in the midst of the night, hiding from everybody, and they are plotting and whispering, except that Allah is their fourth one. Subhanallah. وَلَا خَمْسَةٍ إِلَّا هُوَ سَادِسُهُمْ. Nor among five, but He is their sixth. Five people, Allah is their sixth. And then He says, وَلَا أَدْنَى مِنْ ذَلِكَ. And less than that, nor fewer than that, i.e. two and one, when you are by yourself, Allah is with you. You are two, Allah is your third. You are three, Allah is your fourth. We are 1,000. Allah is the 1,000 and one. We are 1 billion. Allah is 1 billion and one. He is always with us. And then he says, وَلَا أَدْنَى مِنْ ذَلِكَ وَلَا أَكْثَرَ, nor fewer than that, nor more. إِلَّا هُوَ مَعَهُمْ أَيْنَمَا كَانُوا, he is with them wherever they may be. Put 1,000 lions under that, wherever they may be. Then Allah says, ثُمَّ يُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا عَمِلُوا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, then he will disclose to them on the day of judgment all they have done. Forget Mondays, forget Thursdays, it's a lie. There is no Mondays and there is no change that and right this. Between our actions and us seeing our actions is judgment day. That's why Allah says here, then he will disclose to them on judgment day all that they have done. Inna Allaha bikulli shay'in alim, indeed Allah knows everything. You see, can you see with me? How could our big shot sheikhs miss this ayah? Tell me, can anyone help please? Because the question is, what is it that Allah doesn't know that the angels need to show him of our actions to make him know? Does Allah know and he acts like he doesn't know? This is a problem. Is he doing this kind of things purposely like that, without any purpose, just like that? Because he just, okay, I know everything, I know what you're doing, I'm with you. But you know what, angels, hey, come on, raise your actions on Monday and Thursday and let me look at them and then I will decide that. It's incredible the amount of insult that are in hadith and statements of the sheikhs. We all know that this is not how our good God functions. And the question is, what is wrong with those men of religion? To keep people on their toes, they added two other liars. One is, they said, again, the yearly actions in Sha'ban. There is a hadith, again, reported by An-Nasa'i and authenticated by Al-Albani, where they say, I said, one companion, he said, O Messenger of Allah, I do not see you fasting any month as much as in Sha'ban. He said, I am willing to sacrifice all my kids, that none of this hadith came, where he orders came from the mouth of Rasulullah. It's impossible. Impossible. But we have them, so we have to deal with them. Then they said that he said, that is a month to which people do not pay much attention. And it is, now this is the lie. Our scholars differed about the fourth month that is a sacred month. Some of them Sha'ban, some of them said Shawwal, some of them, it's a battle out there. But because this hadith, the narrator of this hadith, the sheikh who narrated this hadith, in his own belief, he knows he wants to push Sha'ban. So Sha'ban, everybody knows Sha'ban. But what did he do? He goes, because he knows the other sheikhs will twist and will change the meaning. So they added this precautionary expression. It is between Rajab and Ramadan. That's it. Sha'ban between Rajab. It's like I'm telling you, oh, I'm coming in December, and that is between November and January. It's a complete redundant information. But that's how our big sheikh roll. Anyhow, so even though they claim that our actions are presented to Allah every Monday and every Thursday, that is not enough. Because, and again, each year in the month of Sha'ban, they say our actions get exhibited and raised and shown to Allah. Again, this is the same nonsense. When one of them sheikhs was asked about, when I was doing my research, I found the questions and things like that. One of the people asked this sheikh, he goes, how can that be that every Monday and every Thursday our actions are raised, and then once a year, what's going on? How is that? You know what the sheikh answered? He goes, and what's the problem with that? And what stops that from happening? If Allah wants it, he does it. Their mind is completely out of this universe, these sheikhs. You and your actions, my brothers and my sisters, please know that our actions are recorded right now, real time, as they happen, directly in Al-Kitab Al-Mubin. إِنَّ نَحْنُ نُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى وَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا وَآثَارَهُمْ وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَحْصَيْنَاهُ فِي إِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ. Allah says, it is us that will give life to the dead people. And again, we write the actions and the actions that they have influenced, and everything is minutely, audited and documented in Al-Kitab Al-Mubin. So everything that we do right now, our actions are written in Al-Kitab Al-Mubin, the clarifying and the revealing a book of the human deeds. That is a title like I would give if I had to translate it in English, which is right now above with Allah, and our actions are directly recorded there. So that's why when we sin, we ask Allah for forgiveness, because that book is with Allah. And right there and then, when you sin, let's say you sinned on a Wednesday. So you don't wait until Thursday to ask Allah for forgiveness. You sinned on a Wednesday, guess what? You ask Allah straight away, and Allah forgives straight away. Adam, when he sinned, when he ate from the tree, and when him and his wife caused all the headaches, okay, and they were kicked out of Jannah, what did they do? They straight away repented. And if we go by the books, that happened on a Friday. And Friday is not Thursday, and it's not Monday. So Adam should have waited on until Monday comes or Thursday comes. It just doesn't make sense. You see, our actions, as I said, are straightway documented in Al-Imam Al-Mubin. But how are they documented? Allah has for each human being deputized two angels, one on your right and one on your left, that document your actions, the good and the bad of them. Where did we get this piece of information? Well, you'd be happy to know, it's in Al-Quran. Allah says, إِذْ يَتَلَقَّ الْمُتَلَقِّيَانِ عَنِ الْيَمِينِ وَعَنِ الشِّمَالِ قَعِدْ. As the two receivers, because they receive your actions. When you do your actions, you're sending it in front of you to judgment day. And those who will receive these actions are the angels. So these angels, Allah calls them al-mutalaqiyan, those who receive your actions, and they are sitting on our right and on the left. And then Allah goes further and says, مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ. Whenever, whatever the human utters, even a single word, إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. Except that there is an even present watcher. The angels are always watching. When you are not paying attention, they are so full concentrated on you. No matter what you do, you could be, I don't know, you could be doing anything, and you blow air. You fart, okay, and that fart is so, nobody around you would know that you have farted, right? The angels do. It's incredible the amount of what they can record on us. It's incredible. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَاءَتْ سَكْرَةُ الْمَوْتِ بِالْحَقِّ. And the trance of death will bring the truth with it, i.e. your actions. And straight away, when we are about to die, and that is when we start seeing the other world we go into. Not the hereafter, but the world of the dead. And I've already explained about this when I spoke about what the death of my son has taught me. So please go back. It's on YouTube and listen to that. I've spoken more about death. So as long as the human is alive, his deeds are directly documented by the two appointed angels in the Imam Al-Mubin. And keep this in mind, because it is extremely important. But when you die as a human being, all the actions, your personal actions, get finished, because you no longer can pray, you no longer can read the Quran, so that book of action gets closed. However, there is another book that keeps working. It's the same book of actions, but any actions where you have been directly involved, the outcome of those actions will keep writing. I'm going to explain this. Let me take, for example, a porn star, or they call them porn star, the actors in pornography. They shoot movies where the adultery, nakedness, everything that is abhorred is there, right? So the people, they do that movie, and then later on, they stop. They grow old, they die, whatever. Now, the movies, when they were doing the movies, the sins were written against them. The actions that they were doing, they are documented in Al-Imam Al-Mubin, the human action mother book, so to speak, okay? Now, that keeps going on. They die, their actions finish, because they can't fornicate any longer, so they're dead. However, when people watch their movies on the internet, even though those porn actors are dead, but guess what? The book of their sins keeps working, because they have been, they are the ones that triggered the sin. The other side of the coin, so to speak, is let's say somebody builds an orphanage and he sponsors orphans and he gets them to, and then these orphans, mashallah, they grow balanced and they study and now they have built a future, they're working properly, they got married, they got kids. So all what that orphan has accomplished or is accomplishing was because the other man, or maybe you, have done that. Once you die, your own actions, that salat and everything, will stop. But what the outcome from your sponsoring that orphan and the orphanage, it will keep writing good actions for you. And that is the beauty of this is and everything. Alrighty? And then on judgment day, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has terminated everything and finished the world, Allah will reinvent, He will recreate another earth, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come to that earth to hold us responsible, and His holy presence cannot be on this earth. Humans have sinned a lot on that. And because on judgment day, Allah will truly and physically come to earth and to hold us accountable for what we have did, the earth as is today is not befit of Allah's coming. When Allah orders the beginning of judgment day, He will call us from one place, and that place is where we are sleeping. Once we die, again, go back to the talk about what death has taught me, and I speak more elaborately on death. But here Allah says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَن تَقُومَ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضُ بِأَمْرِهِ. And of the signs of Allah is that the heavens and the earth stand by His command. So when whatever Allah commands, the heavens and the earth will obey without asking any question. And the same thing on judgment day. And then Allah tells us, and on judgment day, ثُمَّ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ دَعْوَةً مِنَ الْأَرْضِ. Then on judgment day, when Allah will call you by a single call from earth, you will all just come out. إِذَا أَنْتُمْ تَخْرُجُونَ. Once we get out, it'll be pitch dark. Very, very, very dark. Light will have no presence on that day. The only light that you will ever see is the one you will produce yourself. And that's because of our actions in this life. The gooder you do, the more good actions you do, the more light you get. The more sins you do, the less light you get. If your actions were a beacon of light to humanity, then on that day, that light will follow. And if you have been a source of darkness in this life, you will have no light on judgment day. So when humans come out of the graves, they will find their actions all piled up by the side of their graves. So as soon as we come out of the graves, we will find some bags waiting for us. Good deeds are very light, and bad deeds are extremely heavy. And because our actions aren't just what we do, as I explained earlier on, then guess what? You will find the book of your actions and the book, but the bag of other people's actions. As that's what Allah says, وَلَيَحْمِلُنَّ أَثْقَالَهُمْ وَأَثْقَالًا مَعَ أَثْقَالِهِمْ. And they will certainly carry their own burdens, and then the burdens of others along with their burdens. And that's why you should never do a sin where once you die, that sin will keep working against you. وَلَيُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَفْتَرُونَ. And on judgment day, they will be questioned about what they used to invent. My dear sisters and my brothers, this is why Allah invites us continuously to ask Him for forgiveness. He continuously reminds us and continuously encourages us to repent. Return back to the state prior to your sins. That's what repentance is. Because on judgment day, He will not entertain us. Allah will not entertain you. If you mess it up now and you don't repent, on judgment day is the too late day. I will repeat it. Judgment day is the too late day. There is nothing that you can do that day. Our actions aren't exhibited, nor are they raised to Allah on every Monday or every Thursday, and the gates of the non-existent Jannah do not open on Mondays, and for that matter on Thursday, and our actions aren't raised nor collected from earth each year. All this is a pure nonsense, a pure lie that goes against the Qur'an headlong. And for that, this is a contradiction. In conclusion, I will say this. I truly struggle to understand why the sheikhs, the scholars, the men of religion, call them what you will, but I truly struggle to understand how they can ignore Allah's words. How can they ignore the Qur'an, then openly lie to us and make us believe that they honor, respect, and gratify Allah and His book? It really is very, very, I don't understand, you see. I don't really understand anything. If the Qur'an is the most authentic book, and there is no doubt about it, why do we prioritize the man-made hadiths over the Qur'an? You see, since this Islam, my sisters and my brothers, is built on predecessors, it's always the righteous predecessors, the Salaf, okay? And even though the sheikhs and the scholars of our times have access to computers, and they can just run a simple search in the Quran or the internet, and it will give them every ayah about that Jannah does not exist now, and that it will be created on Judgment Day, and so will Paradise. Even these people, they don't care. And why is that? Because they are protecting the righteous predecessors. Because to them, a righteous predecessors have to be correct and strong. And they have to be right. Because the moment they say the Salaf got it wrong in this particular ayah, even though the hadiths are there, people are going to say, what else did they get wrong? What else are you not telling us? And the Salafi sect are the guardians of the righteous predecessor's catastrophe. I will repeat it. The Salafi sect, the Salafi sect are the guardians of the righteous predecessor's catastrophe. One more time. The Salafi sect are the guardians of the righteous predecessor's catastrophe because they completely alienate Al-Quran, and they tell you Bukhari Muslim. To them, what Al-Bukhari Muslim says is far more important than what Allah says. And by the way, I am not afraid to speak up because I have nothing to lose, absolutely nothing to lose except the Quran if I don't talk. If I know, and I know a lot of things are not correct and they are against the Quran and I don't speak them, the Quran will curse me. This is why the Messenger of Allah in countless ahadith, he says, read the Quran. Read the Quran. You see, if the hadith was part of this Islam, the Messenger of Allah would never ever would have encouraged us to read only the Quran because he'll be missing the other half, right? He would have said, read the Quran. And because they tell you the hadith, and I will cover this when I speak about the Mahdi and the Dajjal and everything, they will tell you that the Messenger, there are hadith where he tells them, I know the names of the young people that will fight the Dajjal. He even tells them, I know the name of the man who will enter Jannah. So, Ya Rasulullah, if you knew the names of these people that are going to be at the end of time, why didn't Allah tell you the name of Al-Bukhari, Muslim, and Abu Dawud? And he could have told us. Once I die, there will come a man, his name Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi. They're going to document a hadith, and this man, I from now will tell you they are great people and I'm going to favor them. Please listen to them. And that would have put an end to our misery. But our sheikh, again, the Salafi sect, are the guardians of the righteous predecessor's catastrophe. And we have to stop that. And alhamdulillah, live a life beautiful. If you want to fast Mondays, Thursdays, do it because you want to do a good deed. Not because your actions are present to Allah, because that will just go against your act. You're doing it all for the wrong reasons. And Allah will not accept it once it's done for the wrong reasons. I pray to Allah this is clear. Until my next contradictions, spend a good day. And until I speak to you again, rest in the mercy of Allah. Avoid making sins, and since we all are humans, we will sin in a way or another, but alhamdulillah, repentance is open to us. You don't have to wait for Mondays or Thursdays. You can ask Allah for forgiveness 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 a year, and the seconds of your life, you can count them in between. This is your brother Abdus Salam, and please stay in the mercy of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.